Ladies and gentlemen, this is the program on constitutional government, and our speaker today is Leon Kass. Leon Kass is a professor emeritus from the Committee on Social Thought at the University of Chicago, and he's a fellow at the American Enterprise Institute. He's a graduate of the University of Chicago, his BA, and he got an MD also at Chicago, and a PhD in biochemistry from Harvard. So he has both, he's both kinds of doctor, medical and, I smile, philosophical. That's very unusual. And he taught great books in the Chicago Common Core program, and he studied with worked with and published with his wife, Amy Kass. The late Amy Kass. He and Amy had a marriage of souls, and they became, for this reason or some other, experts on marriage and courtship, and they taught together on this subject and spoke on it too. Great prophet of the students who are there to listen. He is author of several books, or perhaps I should say many, Toward a More Natural Science, Biology and Human Affairs, The Hungry Soul, Eating and the Perfection of Our Nature. There you see his the connection between his medical and his philosophical understanding. And perhaps most relevant for today, The Beginning of Wisdom, Reading Genesis, came out in 2003. And there was also, towards the end of Amy's life, an anthology that he did with her and with Diana Schaub, What So Proudly We Hail, The American Soul in Story, Speech, and Song. And, of course, he was also the head of the President's Council on Bioethics from 2002 to 2007, an office that he held with great distinction, and he presided over an especially very profitably diverse group of scholars. So he's going to talk today on the Ten Commandments. Leon.
Thank you. Thank you, Harvey. It's very nice to be back here and also to see so many old and good friends. I thank you all for coming. Especially nice to see Mary Ann Glendon, who labored with me in that diverse council, heroically, I might add. The paper that I've circulated is part of a larger project on the Book of Exodus. Whether I will live long enough to finish it, I don't know. But it continues my wisdom-seeking reading of the Hebrew Bible. Harvey mentioned the book I did on Genesis. I was rather eager to see how this thing turned out. Having gotten the Israelites into Egypt, now beginning in Exodus, we have the story about their enslavement and how a multitude of ex-slaves becomes a people out of, but also defined against, Egypt. This is, I suppose, the connection between the program on constitutional government. We're talking about a political founding, and one of, I think, not merely historical or religious interest. I'm especially interested in the role of law and legislator in the formation of this people. And peculiarly, this is a people who had a law and a moral and spiritual teaching before they had a land and before they had an economy, I think unique in human history. They become a people in the desert primarily as a result of the giving of the law. The law is quite literally totalitarian in the sense that it touches the totality of human life in all of its details. In Exodus and continuing into Leviticus, you have not only tort law and criminal law, but teachings on religious festivals, the building of a sanctuary, the establishment and of the priesthood, the institution of sacrifices, and finally a holiness, so-called holiness code, including dietary restrictions and laws on forbidden unions, reminding those of you who read Aristotle's Politics, where he says that separated from law and justice, he is the worst of the animals, especially with regard to sex and eating. So Leviticus had this figured out. The Decalogue is the most famous part of the law, but as I read it, it's in fact primarily the preamble to the law which follows. It states primarily the principles of the law, less a legal code in the way in which we tend to regard it, and more an aspirational guide for the people here being formed. And the purpose of this talk, this essay, was to try to understand the meaning and the rationale of these principles and teachings, and to do so in a way that might point to the possibly enduring moral and political, and I would suggest even universal, significance of the Decalogue. Some of you will have read the paper, some of you will not. To the former, I'll apologize. To the latter, I hope this will be helpful. I'm going to proceed by, as it were, turning pages in the paper, largely summarizing the major parts, but reading verbatim certain passages along the way that make what are for me the most important or the most provocative points. And I really look forward to the conversation, which is actually why I came. There's a handout before you on two sides. On the front is simply the structure of the text of the so-called Ten Commandments. And on the back are some passages relevant to my discussion of the Sabbath day and to the discussion of honoring father and mother, the two parts of the Decalogue on which I'm going to, on which I focus in the paper and in which I'm going to concentrate here. The first part of the paper deals with the structure and the context. We note that the Decalogue deals and relates the teachings on the relation between man and God and man and man. Almost all of the statements are in the negative, suggesting that human beings are more in need of restraint than encouragement. But there are two positive statements that stand out, one about the Sabbath, one about honoring father and mother. They are, as I repeat, the main content of today's discussion. And I want to contend that those two principles are more than anything else, the defining principle of principles of the Israelite polity. That's the real contribution against the prevailing ways of the ancient Near East, and therefore it would be worthwhile trying to figure out what those two things are about and what they contribute to a decent and even more than decent polity. The most important thing to remember, and the paper, unless you keep this in mind, and the treatment of the Ten Commandments in isolation is likely to forget, is that the Decalogue fits into a new people-forming covenant between the Lord and Israel proposed by God through his prophet Moses immediately before the chapter in which the Decalogue appears. And I remind you, the overall terms of this covenant are very succinctly put. If the children of Israel will, A, hearken to my voice, and B, keep my covenant, then as a consequence, quote, ye shall be mine own treasure from among all peoples, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. And this is the first place with this offer of a divine covenant that this multitude of ex-slaves learns for the first time that they can become a people among the other peoples of the earth, and that they can become a truly special people, a treasure unto the Lord. And more importantly, their special place is defined in more than political terms. They are invited to become, whatever it means, a kingdom of priests and a holy nation, and we'll return to that later. second part of the paper on Yahweh, thy God, or I and thou, the important thing to keep in mind is that the way in which the speaker, Yahweh, introduces himself at the beginning of this of these statements, I, Yahweh, am thy God who brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. The Jews treat this as the basis of the of a commandment to worship the one God, but I think in the context it really is rather like the announcement of the identity of a speaker who in a, any kind of suzerain and vassal relation is going to tell you who is speaking and how he wants to define this particular relationship in the remarks that follow. The relationship, as we hear, is at this point founded in a historical event, the recent deliverance from the land of Egypt out of the house of bondage. There's no reference here to the patriarchs or to the promised land, but this is a new covenant, not abrogating the old, but adding to it something based upon their all of their recent deliverance. The other thing from this section that I would underline is, although the foundation of this new relationship is, as I just noted, historical, rooted in God's deliverance of the Israelites from bondage in Egypt, the declaration, I think, can be read as presenting a more philosophical message. It seems to me that the Lord is suggesting that for the children of Israel, if not also for other unnamed auditors, there really are two basic alternatives. Either be in relation to the Lord in whose image humankind was created, or be a slave to Pharaoh, a human king who rules as if he were himself divine. And Egypt, which is identified redundantly as the house of bondage, is presented here not just as one alternative among many, but as the alternative to men living as to the alternative to living as men and women whose freedom, not only from bondage to Pharaoh, but to their own worst tendencies, seems to depend on embracing the covenant with the Lord. And this may make a more general point. I read the presentation of the formation of the nation of Israel against several permanent alternatives, of which Egypt is the most interesting and preeminent one. But over here are the Canaanites, and back there are the Babylonians, and here are the Egyptians, and they represent different kinds of alternatives. But the primary people-forming alternative is out of Egypt and against everything that Egypt stands for. And I think this is basically, he's really saying to them, look, either Pharaoh or me. And that means if Egypt is a permanent human possibility, what we might learn from here might be, and I'll say just sort of provocatively, there are ways in which, this would be the most provocative things to say. There are strands of Egypt in America. Okay. The third part, which I'm not going to discuss at all, man seeking God. If after God begins by sort of declaring his relation to the people, you wonder what is his teaching about what their relation to him should be. And instead of getting any positive teaching, you have three successive statements about things that they ought not to do in relation to him. There should be no other gods. There should be no images that should be worshipped. And there should be no vain use of the divine name. This is about how they are not to conduct their side of the relationship. There is in this section, there are interesting things there, especially on idols and image making, and that becomes a very big deal throughout the rest of the story. And if anybody wants to talk about it, we can. But on the face of it, I'm eager to move from the negative teachings to the positive teaching. There is no positive teaching to this point. Very striking. No. Nothing about worship, nothing. And the first instruction to build an altar comes only in the immediate sequel to the announcement of the Decalogue, where people say to Moses, "You talk to us." We don't want to, you know, it's almost as if, in fact, the text says, it's just beautiful. Text says, and the people saw, the thunder. And it's an indication that the senses were completely overwhelmed, and I wouldn't be surprised if they didn't hear a thing, if they really didn't hear. They're so overawed by the spectacle of this. And then God says, okay, if you're going to have an altar, don't build it out of stone, and for goodness sakes, make sure the priests wear long pants so there's no exposure when they mount there. But it's a kind of afterthought to say something about actually building an altar. So in the actual enunciation of the principles, where is there any teaching about what God wants of his people in relation to him? And the answer, I suggest, is really over the horizon in the teaching on the Sabbath. So that's where I want to go next. Okay, so far? Okay. To save some time, I'll just let you reread the paragraph, the text on the Sabbath day. The essence of it is remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy, et cetera, et cetera. And then a reason is given toward the end, which we will revisit. The reason for this practice of work 6 days and not laboring on the seventh has to do with the Lord's behavior in the creation, told to human beings in the story for the first time here. The reader of Genesis has the advantage over the Israelites. We read the first chapter. They didn't know anything. Okay? So this is where that instruction about what happened at the beginning is told to human beings for the first time. Okay. I try to read the text as naively as possible, and I try to imagine myself there at the mountain and even imagine myself actually hearing this. And what in the world would I come away with thinking about remember the Sabbath day, and what would I know about keeping something holy? Well, they would know about the Sabbath day something from the antecedent provision of the manna, which is provided when they're grumbling and moaning, and God sends the manna, but with orders that they should take only was what they need. Nothing should be stored overnight, and nothing gathered on the Sabbath. He would provide double portion the day before. And he does this, he says, in order to test them to see whether they will keep his law. But the more interesting thing in the larger context is the other reference for a view of the Sabbath. The ancient Near East had its own version of the Sabbath in connection with the way they reckoned the 7-day cycle of time, tied not to a teaching about the creation but to the phases of the moon. And their Sabbath, in fact, so-called Shabbatu or Sabbatu, was the day of the full moon, the 14th day of the month. And these days were fast days, days of ill luck, days of dread, and people just desisted from doing anything important. And against this kind of dread-filled naturalistic view, the Sabbath teaching of Exodus institutes a reckoning of time independent of the motion of the heavenly bodies, in which the day for desisting comes always in regular and repeatable cycles and is to be celebrated as a day of joy and of benison. As I say, the readers of the text, the Bible, know this from the beginning. But this is a place where the children of Israel learn that time in the world, and therefore their life in the world, is going to be understood with no relation to the heavenly bodies. And it's at this point that a creation-centered and man-centered view of the world enters human existence through the covenant that is here being enacted. This is in keeping with the polemic that the first chapter of Genesis is engaged in silently against the belief that the divine beings are really those things aloft, the sun, the moon, the stars, those eternal, beautiful things that move in ever perfect circles, etc. The sun is created only on day 4. And what's it for? It's just to mark the already divided day from night, etc., etc. You have vegetation without the sun. You have light without the sun. This is the first cultural teaching in relation to the demotion of the heavens. And when you look to see what is supposed to be holy in this people, other peoples have sacred places, sacred rituals, sacred persons, sacred animals. In Israel, what is made holy is not a special object, but the time of your life. So the holy is not someplace far away, but is built into the fabric of daily life. The key to understanding why this is holy is given in the reason. The reason that 6 days you should labor, but stand down and desist on the seventh, is in fact what they are told of the original creation. Every week, the children of Israel are, as it were, returned in memory to the ultimate beginning and source of the world, and they're summoned to remember and to commemorate its divine creation and creator. But, and this is, I think, really one of the most powerful points, they're not only summoned to recall the creation, but they are enjoined to be like God, both in the 6 days of work and especially on the day of desisting. The relationship to the Creator, as enunciated here, is no longer going to be based solely in historical time and in their parochial deliverance from Egyptian bondage. Rather, it's also rooted in cosmic time and in the universal human capacity to celebrate the created order and its creator, and also the human special place as the one God-like, God-imitating and emulating, and God-praising creature. Here is a reason given to Israel for keeping the Sabbath, which is open to anybody. The deliverance from Egypt is parochial, but the Sabbath observance is enjoined upon them from something that, well, only with the help of the Bible, but nevertheless is accessible to human beings as human beings. Okay. There's some other stuff about, I'll just skip over, but there's reference then back to the Genesis story, which I visit, and notice that God, by standing down and adding a day to the creation of mobile things, has somehow marked in the time of the world and in the rhythm of the world a mysterious aspect of being which is beyond motion and beyond time. And that in remembering this, the Israelites are also in some way able to participate or at least point to something which is beyond change and beyond motion and build that into the nevertheless time-bound and mobile way of life that all of us creatures necessarily have. I point out that the existence of Sabbath rest is a partial reprieve from the sentence of unremitting toil that was prophesied at the end of the story of the Garden of Eden, but point out that this rise to godlike peace, unlike the self-directed fall into the knowledge of good and bad, depends not on disobedience, but obedience, and the path, therefore, the route to doing as I did or being as I am comes from doing as I say. That law is, in fact, not suppression, but law is a form of lifting up. That just by the by. And finally, in this section, I try to draw out some suggestions, really, about why the Sabbath teaching could be the basis of a humanistic politics. One notes that in who's to participate in the Sabbath, all members of the community are to imitate the divine. It teaches the radical equality of human beings, each of whom may be understood to be equally God's creature and equally in his image. Sabbath observance, now I'm going to quote a paragraph, thus embodies and fosters the principle of a truly humanistic politics. Although not incompatible with political hierarchy, the idea behind the Sabbath renders illegitimate any regime that denies human dignity or that enables one man or some few men to rule despotically as if he or they were divine. And by reconfiguring time, elevating our gaze, and redirecting our aspirations, Sabbath remembrance promotes internal freedom as well by moderating the passions that enslave us from within. Fear and despair, owing to a belief in our lowliness, greed and niggardliness, owing to a belief in the world's inhospitality, and pride and hubris, owing to a belief in our superiority and self-sufficiency. I then go on to point out the deep connection between the Sabbath and political freedom by picking up the repetition of the Decalogue by Moses in Deuteronomy. And there the reason given for Sabbath observance rests not on God's creating the world, but on the Exodus from Egypt. You have the passage on the back. Remember, you were a slave in Egypt. The Lord took you out with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord thy God commanded thee to keep the Sabbath. The substitution of the reason of liberation from bondage for the remembrance of the creation invites us to see, perhaps, that this second reason is a logical consequence of the first. Where human beings do not know or acknowledge the bountiful and blessed character of the given world and the special relationship of all human beings to the source of that world, where they are in danger of lapsing into worship either of powerful but indifferent natural forces or of powerful and clever but amoral human masters and magicians. And I go on to suggest that the worship of brute nature and the veneration of clever men finally amount to the same thing, that both deny the special godlike standing and holy possibilities of every single human being and of humanity as such. How am I doing? I got 5 to 10 minutes?
Sure, fine.
Is that all right?
Of course.
Let me do the section on honoring father and mother.
Yes, we mustn't leave that out.
Well, I think, yeah, right. This is the second positive commandment, and that it is a radical innovation in the political teaching of the ancient Near East, and I would say also of the West, is already hinted at by two things that would escape our notice because we are children of this tradition. Honor your father and your mother is an innovation. Against patriarchal cultures in which children are named for their patronym, with their patronyms, and where pride and place are given only to manly males, the Decalogue treats father and mother equally. And we also take for granted, because we are children of this tradition, that we ought to, at least until recently, we took for granted that we ought to honor our parents. But the tradition against which this is an innovation would have been surprised to give pride of place to parents as opposed to heroes, civic leaders, Moses, you name it. That the parents should be elevated in the principle of the community, singled out for special honor, is in keeping with what parents alone can do, which is to say, the work of perpetuation, which is absolutely central to the covenantal idea, which is here the basis of this community, to pass a way of life on from generation to generation. And as an aside, and Harvey, you can come at me on this, part of the secret of doing this is to transform the standing of the males in the community, to domesticate their aspiration, and to turn, as symbolically this is done already in Genesis, to turn circumcision, which was practiced in the ancient Near East, on young males when they left the community of women and children and became warriors, to something the father does to a son on the eighth day, to remind the father that the son has to be reared in the tradition of the ancestors. Not the warrior, but the father to the wife's children is the prime place of honor in this community. I added some things to provoke. It might be why they lost a lot of wars, but never mind. I then go on to consider how honor might be different from love and obedience, other things that you might expect. I think there's a footnote to Cordelia's speech to Lear about why that she honors him but cannot love him as demanded, etc. Go on to talk about how honor is somehow not altogether congenial and goes against the grain and presupposes distance and inequality and looking up to another as superior with reverence, with respect, and even with a tinge of fear. And it turns out that when in Leviticus, at the end of the Holiness Code, actually at the end of the chapter about the forbidden unions, which lay out in detail the Israelite sexual teaching, he then speaks and summarizes, "Ye shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. Ye shall fear, revere each man his mother and his father, and ye shall keep my Sabbaths. I am the Lord." In the succinct summary of what the holiness principle is, these two things are put together. Fear, revere your mother and your father, a repeat, slightly modified, for honor your father and mother, and keep the Sabbath. A kind of indication of my own intuition that the two positive commandments in the Decalogue are absolutely central to the teaching of holiness, which is the special mission of this people to become a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. And I try then to figure out why. What's the big deal about honoring your father and mother? Why has it been elevated to this point apart from its utility? And I take up the possibilities that, of course, gratitude is owed and honor is owed for the gift of birth and of nurture. Parents, and this is in a way worth saying in an age when we live in an increasingly anti-natal culture, parents who have children are affirming the goodness of the world. And they basically say the world is good and we contribute to keeping its going. And in that sense, they are modeling something of the teaching for which we've just heard is to be celebrated. So I think about that. We think about the necessity of this unequal relation of honor to get the work of rearing done, firm but benevolent. But I think it's not yet sufficient to talk about why it's fitting or why it's useful. And on the assumption that God reserves his most important teaching to address those aspects of human life that are most in need of correction, one has to remember, I think, the problems that this injunction especially is meant to address, the dark and the tragic troubles that lurk in the human household and which, absent biblical instruction, would imperil all decent ways of life. And these are the iniquities of incest and of patricide. And then in the part of that discussion, which I think probably will strike most of you as a stretch, but which is what I think might be a real contribution, I call attention to the fact that the last time the word father and mother has been used, the only time before the Decalogue that the word father and mother has been used in the Bible, is in the story of the Garden of Eden, when it says God presents the woman before the man after having presented the animals which are of not of interest, and he says in a very lustful voice, "This now is flesh of my flesh and bone of my bone. She will be called Isha, woman, for out of Ish, man, she was taken." And I read this not as a nice, as most people read this, as a kind of loving, gentle speech just before the altar, but as a speech of lustful male sexual desire. And he describes her attractiveness in the way in which Aristophanes in the Symposium presents the love as the love of the missing flesh, your own flesh. It's a very corporeal account. You can spiritualize it if you'd like. But almost as if to comment on the man's lustful speech of the love of your own flesh, the text, or the narrator, if you will, interposes himself with a commentary and says, "Therefore, a man will leave his mother and father and cleave to his wife, and they shall be as one flesh." I take that not as a commentary on monogamous marriage, but as a commentary on the danger of incest within the family and a kind of warning against it. A kind of, here is the love of your own flesh is a formula for incest. And the text at that point, I think, rises up to call attention to exogamy rather than as our disreputable friend Rousseau talks in the Discourse on the Origin of Languages. I think that's where it is, about the beginning, where they were all incestuous. Is that the right text? I think near the beginning. No. They became husband and wife without ceasing to be brother and sister. Maybe the second discourse. Never mind. It's not a new thought to say that in the beginning, before there is law commending exogamy, and you see in the Holiness Code in Leviticus the extensive emphasis on the forbidden unions, and meant to protect the lines who belongs to whom, and above all to protect the domain of the relation between parents and children. So I take that to be one of the targets. And the other is the target of rebellion in the house, not just incest, but patricide. And you have a story of metaphorical incest and patricide in the story of Ham seeing the nakedness of his father and celebrating his father's unfatheredness, and that is in that section too. So, and to sum up this particular section, and it will I think do almost for summing up the whole. I suggest that the teaching about honoring father and mother is a teaching not only about gratitude, creatureliness, and the importance of parental authority, but that insists on sacred distance, respect, reverence, precisely to produce holiness in that all too intimate nest of humanity that often becomes instead a den of iniquity and a seedbed of tragedy. And the Greeks taught us that from the beginning. The household is the home of tragedy, absent other things. In the Sabbath observance, a correction is offered against the especially Egyptian penchant for human mastery and pride that culminates in despotism and slavery. In honoring father and mother, a correction is offered against the especially Canaanite penchant for sexual unrestraint, including incest, that washes out all distinctions and lets loose a wildness incompatible with the created order and with living under the call to be a holy people. Adherence to these two teachings offers us the best chance for vindicating the high hopes the world carries for the creature who is blessed to bear the likeness of divinity. I think, Harvey, I should stop and leave time for discussion. I'll just mention two things that are coming, that are in the paper afterwards, which if anybody wants to take up, I would be especially pleased. I go on to say something about the vexed question of the universality versus the parochialism of God's teaching to Israel. And I try to defend both the universality of the teaching, but the necessity of parochialism, and that there's something to be said about a parochial people that bears a universal way. And you get that from a Sabbath teaching, which is a universalizable teaching that doesn't depend upon your having been delivered from Egypt, but recognizes somehow the created order. And then the most parochial of teachings, honor your own particular father and mother. Anybody who loves humanity as a whole and who does not care for the immediate neighbor doesn't get the message. And that goes on to talk really about the importance of both of these things. Finally, in the last section on the so-called second table, the thing which is of greatest interest is the statement about not coveting. And this is one of those places where I think people who say the Old Testament is just about external rules and doesn't speak about things of the heart would have to revisit. I mean, this is a remarkable thing that there should be a pronouncement, not just about not murdering, committing adultery, stealing, or bearing false witness, but about the state of your heart. And I think I close really with too brief a reflection on why this is a meditation on the character of healthy desire and what it means to have neighbors, and why it's a kind of teaching that the unshareable things which would lead one to do unneighborly things ignores the fact that the truly shareable things are the things which my having them do not preclude your having them, are in fact the true basis of a community. and which is to say the other teachings that are here. Those are false gods, the things that one desires that belong to one's neighbor, as well as getting in the way of your neighbor's chance of living a decent life. But that's both too much and too little, but I'm really eager for the rest, so thank you for your patience.
Thank you so much. Now, questions? Proposals? Yes.
I would like to ask you to expand that topic, universality versus parochialism you just mentioned, because throughout your presentation today, you have highlighted the universal, philosophical, you also said, aspects of revelation and so on. But in some parts of your paper, you actually underscore the more parochial or cultural element. For instance, on page 6, you describe the declaration of monotheism not as philosophical, but as cultural. And on page 6, I've seen that regarding the legal, founding legal code, you say that it can be an aspirational guide for every Israelite and perhaps every human heart and mind. So the paper seems to be less straightforward about that. Implication, so I would like you to explain if possible a little bit better that interesting.
Yeah, good, and maybe
thank you.
Maybe we could get more than just my response on this, because this is, I think, a very big both theoretical and practical problem in a world in which there are certain tendencies that move simply in universalizing directions about how we should sort of think about ourselves. There are things that are... I always used to think that this was a strictly parochial and national teaching, until I stumbled on the fact that when God opens the discussion of the Decalogue, I don't say it's unique, but it's very rare. And God said, God spoke all these words saying, and it doesn't say to whom. That's very unusual. It almost always, there's the, it's specified who the auditor is. I gloss that by saying, maybe anybody can listen. I mean, there are people at the mountain. They're obviously the immediate auditor, but maybe what's being said here is not for them alone. And also, by the way, the assignment to them is that they are to be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. And the question is it just that this is going to be a little island amongst humanity, or is there to be a light unto the nations? God tried all kinds of universal ways to begin with, and after their failures, starts over with Abraham. And it's not that he's given up on humankind. He's trying to get a toehold for his new way in the world. And ultimately, the question is this a way which can somehow inform the way other people live? Then my sense of the universalizing direction comes when I see the transformation between the purely parochial reason for accepting this as your God. You want to know who I am? I'm not just the guy who makes the mountain rumble. I'm the one who brought each one of you personally out of Egypt. But then the reason given for doing the one thing that God said he wants done, the one way you can be holy, is based upon something which you didn't have to go out of Egypt in order to understand. That's clearly universalizing reason. It seems to me that organized life is life lived in our embodied selves and with networks of begetting and belonging and association that for certain universalizers is sort of to be deplored. It's sort of too bad that we can't simply live as universally as we can in our thoughts. But the Bible, I think, celebrates our embodiment. It celebrates the fact that sanctified time enters our lives in our households. And therefore, there's a kind of celebration of the necessary associations that embodiment and partiality produce. And rather than say, and I in the end, it was probably not right to do this, but suggested really that unlike Jesus' teaching, God doesn't say, leave your father and mother and follow me. But that there's a celebration that grace comes locally and parochially in the life that we have been given to live as well as we can. And I would, so I mean, it's sort of paradoxical. There's a kind of universal, I think there's certain universal principles here, but one is not somehow to turn one's back on the associations which begin really in the household and extend to a community in which I think one would also want to say can be self-governing under law. And those have to be communities, at least until the Federalists, that are limited in scope.
Mm-hmm. Martha.
Sure. I have a question that follows up on this gentleman's question.
Please.
Sure. I was wondering about the status of the Ten Commandments altogether, the authority. Are they the Word of God? Okay. And is that the authority? And then I'm thinking about Thomas Aquinas, whom, as you well know, called them the dictates of reason. And call them the practical content of natural law, written on the hearts of all human beings. So, what say you? yeah. So it, dictates of reason, is God the authority? Is it some? This I think is a little bit along the lines of what this gentleman was suggesting: universal versus particular.
Well, I mean, they could be. God could be the authority and it could still be universal, right? I mean, I'm here expounding the text. The text is quite clear as to where the authority, who the ultimate lawgiver is. I don't have a problem with that. However, it always seems to me worth thinking about whether God, in whose image we are made, and therefore have some kinship with, might in fact have reason for his things that are said, and the obedience would certainly not be made more onerous, and might even be made less onerous, if you could somehow see into the whys of this. The reason for obedience does not rest upon your saying, "I figured it out, and I'll say yes," although it's quite wonderful. He offers them the covenant. The passage I read, if you will keep my commandments and keep my covenant, then you will be my treasure, etc. And the people said, what you have said we will do. And Moses reports, they're on board. They didn't understand a thing. At least they haven't got a clue as to what they've signed up for. But they've seen an alternative. They've seen an alternative. And in a way, the whole education of the Exodus and the rest had to, and they had to, in minuscule little steps, if you're really doing people formation, you begin by having to say something like, they all had to, on the night of the Exodus, they had to vote for their deliverance. Those Israelites who didn't mark their door didn't come out. When they got to the Sea of Reeds, and the Egyptians are chasing them between a rock and a hard place, and they start yelling at Moses, weren't there enough graves in Egypt? And Moses tells them, you stand still, God will provide. And God tells Moses, for goodness sakes, lead. Tell him to walk. And God helps those who will help him help themselves. The same with the manna. There were a series of steps in which these people had to bring themselves somehow to the point that they were willing to consent. This is a covenant in which, admittedly in great ignorance, but somehow, more than half-heartedly, they said yes. Okay? Their ability to continue to say yes, it would be enhanced to the degree to which the things that are commanded, they're commanded to do, make sense. And that's partly what I'm trying to do, to figure out, you know, assuming that God is not irrational and not some willful bully who likes sort of tossing his weight around, it ought to be, we ought to be able to think about, I mean, this is one person's attempt. I would be glad to be shown that there's a better way of understanding these things. But I think that, as a beloved teacher friend of mine said, who used to teach Hebrew Bible on the side at St. John's, a student said in disbelief, Mr. Kaplan, do you mean to say that God spoke Hebrew? And he said, there were 600,000 witnesses.
I have a question about politics. So sort of unpolitical character of the Ten Commandments. You were in general pushing it in the direction of friendliness to politics. You said three things that interested me. First, would it be the case that politics equals the Pharaoh? And that if God is the alternative to the Pharaoh, that doesn't sound good for politics. But then, under honoring thy father and the mother, you spoke not of incest. The incest prohibition means that the family is really an impermissibly narrow unit. If you're a man, you can't marry your sister, much less your brother. And so you have to go outside the family to maintain the family.
So okay.
The family doesn't survive on its own, but it needs a larger organization to legislate for the relations between families,
right,
and for the succession of families. Inheritance, that's not a family regulation, that's a political regulation,
right.
What happens after somebody dies. I'm thinking of an argument by John Locke in his first treatise, which has to do with honoring thy father and mother. Right in the very center of that first treatise, he considers the father and mother commandment and asks whether, does this mean that your parents are agents of God, or that they have a delegation of power from God in which they have some discretion? And he quotes something, I think it's from Deuteronomy, a case of a parents who killed their son, who was a glutton and drunkard. And it wasn't against the other commandments to be a glutton and drunkard, but it was against their commandments. So this was, so to speak, an addition on their part. And they were not just passing on God's commands, which he had, in other words, does
the tyranny of the family.
Yes. Well, right.
Okay.
Does the family indicate a sort of grant of power to the parents, or is it does it leave them in the situation of instruments,
stewards,
who simply carry out laws that he has otherwise made, and could not be authorized to venture into gluttony and drunkenness?
Let me come at these backwards and with one general preface. To repeat the point that the Ten Commandments are really the preface to a whole bunch of other laws, okay? And the whole bunch of other laws are, in a way, not even a full legal code because they don't cover all the cases, et cetera, et cetera. Honor your father and mother is glossed in the specific legal code in the most astonishing way, astonishing to me. There are four capital offenses amongst the ordinances. Premeditated murder, kidnapping with a intent to sell into slavery, and then striking your father and mother and cursing your father and mother. So this is not yet to answer, but it's to treat this as particularly heinous crimes. I'm inclined to think that it's not that they have been delegated, that they have new powers to, as it were, set themselves up as demigods in their own sphere, even though some might, and I read in the papers that some have so abused the powers that the law has allowed them as parents. But that partly it's for the what one owes them, partly it's what they alone can do, partly it's to keep clear the lines of descent and instruction so that the general teaching can be passed on. I don't know. I mean, there are, I don't know any passages that would justify that particular thing of which Locke is speaking. And I'm not sure whether in that episode that that particular deed was done with approval or not. Right? I mean, there are people who do things along the way which we're meant to think about, and unless the text sort of comes in and puts its weight behind what's done, one can't seem to. So the fact that it happens doesn't mean that even if that tyrannical father thinks he has somehow got special delegated new authority, that would be the tradition. Of course, the family is just the foundational unit, but exogamy necessarily points beyond the family to a larger community, and the whole set of laws given here were intended to be the foundation of a self-governing community, self-governing and worshiping community. So I didn't want to say that, I shouldn't have implied that by the focus solely on the family, one was ignoring the importance or even the superior importance of the larger place. But I think the point is you could not have a decent community if you get the family thing wrong. And if you need a monument, look around. On the first point, this would take a lot of doing. I think it's Chesterton's remark, a man who doesn't believe in God, doesn't believe in nothing, he'll believe in anything. And we haven't seen the last act of the West on this subject. The rise of an administrative state, the rule of technocracy, the consolidation of power, the centralization of authority. Egypt is a tremendous place. Mastery of nature, magic, ancient Egypt. What made it possible what's the connection between what was great about Egypt and the kind of despotic rule in which it issued? What restrains? Joseph, and it's perfect. Joseph is a genius of administration. He knows nothing about the human heart. So Joseph is the anti-Moses. Joseph comes in there and he teaches Pharaoh how to be Pharaoh. He consolidates all his power. He buys up the land. He enslaves the people. And by the time Joseph's finished, Pharaoh he's really the despot that he hadn't been to that point. But that's based upon a certain kind of cunning about the management of affairs and insight into natural events. So we've lived a long time without having to think about these as the only alternatives. But America was, in addition to Lockland, the place that the Puritans had something to do with.
Good.
If I may. All right. There was a hand in the back. Please.
Okay. Something occurred to me looking at the paper at home, and then in reference to remarks that, you know, is this your contribution to Judeo-Christian values? Because you know, I don't know if there's anything wrong with that, but
it's been done.
Well, you spoke about this difficulty of the universal and the particular. I mean, isn't Christianity the most famous attempt to solve the problem? I mean, it just seems it would. You know, if you want a wisdom literature version, it could be a Christian, like wisdom literature looking at Christian interpretations of the Ten Commandments. I get the impression that that's not what you're after, your primary motive, but I wonder if you could state why you might be underwhelmed to be described as an exponent of Judeo-Christian.
Why it might be
underwhelmed by being described, say, as a proponent of Judeo-Christian sort of general wisdom literature. It seems because you're pushing towards a kind of, if I could say, your defense of parochialism is Jewish.
Jewish, yeah.
If I could say so. Yeah, it's Jewish. I know.
I would like to think it's not just an accident of birth.
Yeah. No. So look, I'm just trying to see how you know.
It's Christianity that brought this teaching to the world. And there are no two ways about that. As between that and the lower paganisms that are coming waiting in the wings, I think this is to be defended, honored, recognized. I made a few enemies in my synagogue 20 years ago by announcing, this was in Hyde Park in Chicago, the home of our president, who was at the time in Reverend Wright's place, but never mind, in which I said that serious Jews had less to fear from and more in common with serious Christians than they had with their co-religionist atheists. They're Jewish atheist brethren. And it was just what I think. I don't know that there's anything novel here, and I happen to be working on this, working through the Hebrew Bible, and the business about universalism and parochialism wasn't so much a mode of special pleading, but trying to figure out what does the Bible trying to say when it puts right next to each other the creation of everything and your own particular father and mother. And those two things are the summing up of the holiness code here. What kind of teaching is there about you show me somebody who's got all the right universal opinions and who mistreats his parents or his children, I take no moral lessons from him. That's the polite thing to say. This love of your own is not contemptible. Mr. Whitaker.
You pointed out that there are two of these commandments that are positive, as opposed to the thou shalt nots that we're used to. It seems also that several of them have, you could say, reasons for them. Seven of them don't. They're right. Stated as a commandment. The ones that have reasons, a couple of them look like they have more penalties as reasons, that if you don't do this, you know, there will be, you know, bad things visited upon generations, or you will not be held guiltless, some implied threat there. The two that you focused on, the first, as you pointed out, has a reason as a sort of an example set by God.
Justification,
yeah, okay. Right. So the second, honoring thy mother and thy father, you didn't speak about this so much, so I'd be interested to hear about the reason given there, that thy days may be long upon the land. That seems to me like it's probably the only positive reason, and it's also a very natural reason. I mean, it's not like God created the world in 6 days and the seventh he took a rest, where we have to take that upon God's word, that was the case, and that you can then begin to try to reason it out, that maybe, as you were saying, rest points to something that different than active than a work, and that there's something both divine and humanly ennobling about resting and contemplating and so forth. This fifth reason, though, seems, as I said, very, very, very natural, that, of course, don't we want our days upon this land to be long? And so I'm wondering what you make of that reason, and why it seems to be the one kind of positive reason for. Does that make this commandment in a way more natural or less so, that you have to apply this reason to it, as distinct from, say, the second table, where there's no reasons given, but, you know, as someone mentioned earlier, you're kind of, you know, figure out with your head, like it's, you're not going to enjoy living in a community where people are murdering and stealing and so forth there. So anyway, just what do you make of this positive reason?
Yeah, look, that's, I'm glad you brought it up, because maybe somebody will help me on that. I'm not sure, on the face of it, this is a reason in the sense of a reward or an incentive for obedience, rather than the explanation as to why, the reason behind something. And on the face of it, doesn't make all that much. You think it's natural. It seems to me it doesn't make all that much sense.
The conjunction, maybe, although, as you pointed out, look, the family and parents are honored as procreative, and so life is at the heart of this, and so then, all right, is it the continuation of this life that they have procreated?
That seems to be a direction I would be inclined to go, but I recognize myself that it's a stretch. Mm. It's not that if you are nice to your mother and father, you're going to live to 120, but that what goes around comes around, and it's of a piece, really, with the iniquities of the fathers are visited upon the children, not the sins, and that's really very important. Right. Everybody's responsible for their own sins, mm-hmm. but Oedipus is the classic story. Mm-hmm. There are iniquities and there are pollutions, and they just hang around, and they hang around, mm-hmm. and innocent people get swept up mm-hmm. in it. So here it seems to me that the chances that what it was that you can receive from your parents will live through you to be transmitted another day is somehow, I won't say guaranteed, but it ties somehow, there's certainly on the face of it, there's an obvious sense of what you owe your family of origin, your source of origin, and what will be your life, pointing perhaps to the family of perpetuation, mm-hmm. though it doesn't say that.
Right. It seems very individual.
And I would be happier if it said that.
Yeah.
But I don't. Does anybody have any help on that? Please.
Yeah, well, I'm a grandfather. And that gives me certainly. My new children, precious to me, have their own children who are very precious to them. They'll do anything for those kids, right? They're just endless. Now, they do, I guess, honor their mother and father, but it doesn't seem like it comes quite as natural. So there's no biblical injunction, either in the Old or New Testament, as far as I can recall, that says, honor your sons and daughters. Well, who needs a commandment like that? You know, that's one of those commandments that you just don't need to have, right? So there's something about this that I've always felt when reading this passage is that it really is a point that needs to be made to those kids, right? That they can't just go off and ignore their parents and go off and, you know, focus on the next generation. And of course, their lives may be long upon the face of the earth if they do so, because after all, they've got the same problem downstream. So, anyway, that's my exegesis on that.
That's very nice. And I think, look, God doesn't waste his commandments. You don't need a commandment, love your children, or eat, or breathe. But he has a commandment, be fruitful and multiply, because it's not necessarily with the grain. Given the choice between self-fulfillment and self-sacrifice, there are lots of cultures today who are showing why that would needed to have been commanded. And people, look, this is half of this intergenerational business. There are two deep-seated natural impulses, an impulse to self-preservation and a biological impulse to reproduce, and they are at odds with each other. Yielding to the impulse to reproduce is, in fact, saying yes to your own demise in honor of the generation that's going to replace you, whether you know it or not. And all mammals are like the salmon that swim upstream to spawn and die. We just stretch it out. That's the truth. And in fact, it's it's the human self-consciousness of the tension between those things, which is the seed of eros and the striving for that. So that Socrates can say, on the one hand, eros is striving for immortality, and the other, the desire to give birth. And these are two different aspects of some fundamental thing born of this dichotomy. The self-satisfying impulse, very powerful. And when having children becomes a form of self-fulfillment, as opposed to a sense that you owe for your life and pay in the only way you can by paying forward, the culture has become in trouble. So that's the forward-looking thing. The other thing is the early stories in Genesis before Abraham are, on my reading, paradigmatic stories of what would happen uninstructed. So that these are not stories of what happened once, but they're what happened always. And the story of Noah and his sons is the only story of fathers and sons that you have before Abraham. You don't have any other story. It's placed right after the covenant with Noah. And Noah gets blind drunk, lies unfathered in his tent, is exposed, and he's got one son who thinks this is wonderful, that he traffics in his father's shame. And he's thrilled at his father's unfathering himself and metaphorically castrates him and kills him, metaphorically, without laying a hand on him by going out and blabbing. That kind of rebellion is in the household. If you don't believe it, read the Greek tragedies. So something has to be introduced there in order to produce the kind of awe and reverence and distance and respect. Because otherwise, patricide and revolt in the household. I mean, the Cain and Abel story tells you that the truth about the number two between siblings is enmity to the point of fratricide. And the story of fathers and sons is some of them are pious, some of them are not. God only knows why. But this culture, if it's to somehow preserve the family as the instrument of education and the institution of teaching, has to lean against the natural tendencies, which are tendencies to a kind of sexual wildness and indiscriminateness, and a kind of tendency to disrespect and revolt against the elders. Jonathan.
To bring it to a domain that you're eminently familiar with in bioethics, this challenge of the universal and the parochial or the particular, when your group assigned the nation Hawthorne's birthmark, my reading of it immediately put me in a state of mind about American pluralism. That is, how would the different religious traditions regard what that story is trying to convey? And in some respects, what we're seeing emerging in a national conversation is leaving behind, to some degree, the more what I would describe as parochial bioethics. And there's a larger conversation going on about what the relationship is between Catholic teaching and medicine, Jewish teaching and medicine, Islamic teaching and medicine. And all of those point to this profound difference in parochial and universal perspectives, so that in many respects, a figure like Robbie George is endeavoring to bring to the national conversation ideas and teachings that emerge from Catholic teaching in a way which is intended to be universalistic.
Which is or is intended.
It is intended, yes.
In the spirit of the question earlier about the natural law. Right?
Yeah. Yeah. But the Jewish teaching is very different. The halakhic interpretations, when they get really orthodox, only apply to the Orthodox. It remains parochial in every sense of the word. That's not to say that there aren't readers of those disputations and debates who are trying to bring it into a broader civic conversation. And in response to the question about whether you're doing something new, I think that you've been doing something new for quite a while in that regard, facing the challenge of pluralism. How do we resolve the fact that there are traditions which intend to point themselves to followers, and those who see what their ambition should be is to teach everyone? And it's not a question as much as an observation about when you get asked a question, what you think you're doing. And, and the other thing, just totally unrelated, is there, in Yiddish, you know, there is a whole dynamic going the other direction between parents and children. It's called Naches and Soros.
Yeah. I mean, what you say is really interesting, and I think, I mean, the Jews, for perfectly understandable historical reasons, those who take their, well, there's a whole strand of contemporary Judaism that reads the prophets without the law, and they are the social justice people, and they are universalizers. But the ones who observe the tradition most faithfully or completely look very parochial, because A, they've never lived in their own land until 48, they feel their traditions are under siege, so they're inward looking. And I'm inclined to think that in the modern age, and this really is sort of beside the point of the sort of general discussion, but I'm here, I might as well finish the thought. I'm inclined to think that serious and thoughtful Jews who take their own tradition seriously have something to contribute to America as America. And I ran a seminar for a bunch of Orthodox rabbis. We did some selections from What So Proudly We've Hailed, and the theme of the session was what does America do for Jews in America, and what can the Jews contribute to America as America? And we read, I can't remember the stories. Oh yeah, we read the Maypole of Marymount was one of the readings, particularly to get at the question of the difference between the hyper-pagan Maypolers and the hyper-austere Puritans and this young married couple, Edith and, never mind, Edward, I guess, who enter upon marriage mindful that it's something weighty and grave, and that they have something, both in their joy and in their commitment, that the Puritans have lost. And I try to present this as, in a way, a Jewish story, or a story that has something of kind of Jewish resonance. We had several things on this last session. What is it, you guys have congregations, right? What is it that you think you have to contribute to the community? I set it up. Dialogue. The tradition of dialogue. Not that they had any substantive moral thing to contribute, which is, I think, a loss. It's a loss. That there really is a wisdom in these, all of these traditions, which by keeping them out of the public square and hiding them, we're leaving the public square just for denuded speech. And there's nothing like the weight of understanding and profundity in much of what passes for public discourse if you rule this stuff out, and you don't have to come into it engaged in special pleading. The degree to which you can find reason in these things, you don't then argue from authority, but you then appeal to what human beings, as human beings, might be able to see, recognizing that there are parochialisms that resist certain things which strike everybody else's. How could it be otherwise? It's not very satisfactory, but.
Bernhard Warren, I'm representative from MIT.
That's right.
Professor Trump.
But not here as a representative from MIT.
No, you said something like that.
I was struck by one of the things that you said, one of the alternative or pre-interpretations of the Sabbath, or the Sabbath being, you know, the full moon, a bad day, but in particular you used the term naturalistic.
Yes.
And I was wondering if you could elaborate a bit more on where the naturalistic or nature is in Exodus or the Hebrew Bible. And I guess furthermore, thinking about the introduction to your Genesis book, I assume in this you're taking a similar approach, which is a philosophical approach, presumably. By taking that approach, could you be reading in thoughts about nature that may not have been intended to be there or were, are there?
Yeah, I'm not sure, Bernhard, that I'm really up to doing this right. So let me just say a couple of things. I was probably a little careless by tossing the word naturalistic in there without realizing that there was a whole army marching behind it of ideas. It's very clear that the Bible sets itself from its opening against the what I would take to be a very prominent, if not universal, human tendency to regard as eternal and divine certain natural things. Aristotle says in the beginning, human beings thought the sun and the moon and the stars are gods, but this is a crude paraphrase, and the details are very nice, but since allow me to finish in the crude way. But basically, it was useless for the point of view of politics, and the poets came along and gave them human shape. And civilization then becomes possible as a result of the anthropomorphization of the natural beings. But it turns out everybody knows that this is just poetry, and it gets exposed by various people. The alternatives are you either worship natural beings or you think that nature is completely unendowed and you worship the human makers of who are going to force nature to do our biddings and serve our purposes. And the Bible has a dim view of both of them, and they come up very early. The Bible has a very dim view of cities to begin with. I mean, God eventually has his own city, but the founder of the first city is Cain. Babel is rejected as the universal human city because it's a city of human self-recreation without any acknowledgement of anything that we didn't put there. And in the end, it would fragment itself. God simply hastened the process by breaking it up and separating out all the nations. But the first word on what you might call nature worship is the first chapter. First chapter of Genesis. The sun and the moon and the stars are creatures. They're not gods. And the highest creature is man. And it doesn't tell you, the text doesn't tell you what it means to be in God's image. And, you know, libraries have been built to house the books that have explained that. But if you're just a dumb guy reading what's in the text and you sort of ask yourself, what from this text would you know about God? Never mind, suspend your disbelief in it, but the text tells you things that God can do and does. And you look at these things and God speaks and plans and makes and judges good and bad and shows solicitude, etc., and as shows freedom in making. And you ask yourself, which one of the creatures on that page can do that? And lo and behold, there's one. I mean, the sun might move in perfectly regular motions. It might be beautiful, be a source of light, but doesn't understand that it's there. And so the first chapter really is an attempt very silently to reorient the way in which human beings, or at least the human beings educated by this book, will be in the world. Not looking up to those things, but feeling in their own selves the power to be in relation to the highest and to know it, more or less. I think that unlike your friends, mine, Bacon, and these other people, well, there's a suspicion of craft. There's certainly nothing like the attempt at mastery of nature. But there's also gratitude for the given world. And partly the partly the going back on a weekly basis to remember the creation is to remember that it's very good, notwithstanding everything else that would lead you much of the time to think otherwise. To be is good. To be and to know that to be is good is even better. And to be and to at least to be able to ponder why there is something rather than nothing, and what's responsible for the orderliness of this, and what's responsible for the being of a mind that can carry on a conversation like this, and miracle of miracles, largely understand each other. That shows some appreciation of what other people would call nature, and here one would say is the creation. So there's an appreciation of it, but it's not something to be worshipped, because it doesn't tell you peep about how to live.
Thanks a lot, Leon. This was wonderful.